If you remember, we were discussing about the profile directory structure.
Yeah.
I mean, this particular image, whatever you are seeing on the slide, it shows the DMGR directory structure from a Windows installation. But if you navigate, you know, the app server or the DMGR profile on Linux, it will be pretty much the same. So you need to be aware of a few XML files, which we don't hand edit. When I say hand edit, right, you don't actually open in an editor and make changes. But sometimes if you run into configuration issues, you know, let's say if you're managing a cluster and I mean, you feel that, you know, there is a configuration issue, like one of the nodes in the cluster is not picking up some changes, you know, the application specific deployment changes or WebSphere specific configuration changes, like changing the port number from the console, you know, it is not reflecting for that particular node. So you might be interested to see like what is going on in the backend. So those are the circumstances where you'll be just going through these files in a read-only mode and then confirm few things. Okay. And I mean, though many files are listed, these, I mean, whatever the scenario I just explained, right, those will be like server.xml. You know, you might be interested to take a look at it. I mean, even just for information, I mean, not only that you will have to see when you are having issues, but if you want to see what exactly this file contains, whatever you are making changes to the console, so these will be stored you know, in these XML files, actually all the server definitions, ports, port information, the security settings in security.xml, your JDBC and your data source, you know, provider information in the resource XMLs, all the WebSphere specific you know, Java environment variables in the variables.xml, performance monitoring you know, settings in the PMI config XML, your cluster specific changes or configuration settings in the HA manager service.xml. I mean, even personally, I have not touched a PMI config and HA manager service. I mean, it's very difficult to understand the schema, but frequently, you know, I took a look at server XML, resource XML, and security XML. I mean, unless you are an expert, you know, in making sure how to make these hand edits, okay, there are certain sequences to make sure if something is not reflecting. I mean, there are certain workaround to be followed, which is not even recommended by IBM. But once you, you know, notice something is not synchronized from the DMGR, you know, in the worst case, we'll try to do the hand edits, and then we'll push the changes from DMGR to, I mean, the notes. So, okay. I mean, I'll tell you a very peculiar scenario where you might run into these issues. When DMGR is trying to contact that node and, you know, that node agent process, right, let's say it is running with a specific WebSphere user ID and group ID, and if your file system permissions have been changed since the installation, okay, that you have done, and there is no way that, you know, node agent will be able to edit these files. I mean, if the right permission is revoked or someone changed the settings. So, I mean, in those cases, right, you'll have to perform the operations to make sure those files get the appropriate permissions rather than making the changes, you know, at the file level. So you'll have to fix it at the, I mean, you'll have to consider that environmental issue as the issue for the WebSphere installation as such, not very specific to these files. But you will actually see the files, okay, why, I mean, yeah.
So are you saying that we will install it as a root, R-O-O-T, root user, and then we decided that, you remember we use, I told you we use app serve. So app serve we will use, and then we, after installing, if we'll change from root to app serve, then we'll not be able to change these files. That's what you're
No. That scenario, whatever you are saying, right? Even I have not tried, you know, doing any WebSphere installations from root and then switching that installation to a different user. Okay. If you have decided to perform the non-root installation, you will have to have that in the plan and then start the installation manager tool itself from the non-root user mode, which is like user inst script.
Okay.
Because that will make sure, you know, whatever the appropriate permissions needed for that user account, WebSphere installation itself will give you that, actually, because we don't know, I mean, which file, you know, it is going to be only read-only mode, right? So we cannot manipulate by changing the users for the entire file system, I mean, being a Linux admin or, you know, root user. So that is not recommended.
Yeah.
But what I'm saying is, if something has been changed, though you have installed the files, you know, the WebSphere setup using the non-root user, I mean, there are changes where, I mean, if, you know, without knowing your, I mean, without even letting you know, if some Unix admins have changed something, then you will have these synchronization issues from the DMGR, or sometimes the WebSphere process itself, you know, doesn't come up. So you will have these kind of issues. So from the directory structure, I mean, you know, you'll have to navigate to, I mean, it'll not be a direct indicator wherever you are referring through. I mean, you might get it in the logs if the certain, you know, binary itself is not able to start the process, if it's not able to create logs. So you'll actually get it. I mean, you'll get a permission denied error. But certain cases where these XML files don't take changes, I mean, WebSphere doesn't report very smartly that it is not able to edit these files. So you'll have to navigate, you know, back and forth and find out, you know, what I mean, has been changed, you know, since.
And what is the difference between the resource.xml of DMGR cell and inside it we have server folder?
Correct. So I'll tell you the differences between these resources when it comes to scoping. In one liner, right, we can actually define the resources at different level of scopes. Okay, you can actually define DMGR to be aware of these resources, and you know, all the nodes can actually use the resources defined at the DMGR level, and then, you know, it can be used. It can implement that. Okay, for their own application.
It is okay. These files are scope-wise. That's what you are trying to.
Yes. So that's why you see resources at node level, resources at cell level, resources at server level, which is the recommended configuration actually. Okay. So if you have a cluster, I mean, it is even recommended to define these resources at the cluster level, because you don't have to, you know, let's say if you have five different nodes or four different cluster members, you don't have to define the JDBC settings, you know, for every node. Okay, so you can define it at the cluster level, I mean, which is again recommended. And if you don't have a cluster, I would recommend you to go with the server level, actually, the JVM specific changes, not even at the cell level or the node level. Okay, so that's why you see multiple files, you know, from different, scopes. Okay.
Okay.
So.
Yeah. To disable the admin security, we will go inside the DMVR cell that security.xml, right?
Well, I mean, that's one of the workarounds, I would say, editing that file and, you know, killing the process or something. I mean, just to make sure you revert the security changes. Yeah, that's one of the scenarios where you do that. But you need to have, because let me tell you the reason actually, right? If you make the edit in the security.xml, you need to stop the process, okay, to make sure that changes are picked up. But for you to stop the process, if the security is enabled before, you need to have the password. So that scenario will be helpful only if you know, the admin password is forgotten or lost.
Okay. But if the password is forgotten, how will you enter the password?
That's what. So you cannot enter the password and systematically bring down the processes. So you'll have to kill the process with the help of the Unix admin.
Okay. Okay.
Got it?
Okay.
And that is not recommended also, because we'll have to make, multiple, you know, synchronization, and we'll have to make changes on the cell level, and whatever the nodes which have got these, you know, files, we'll have to restart every server actually to get those nodes.
You're saying if I don't have the password, I know the process, I'll go from Unix machine and then I'll kill the process, and then I'll do the required changes under the DMVR cell level security of XML, and disable the security from there, and then I'll restart it.
You restart it? I mean, that's a process at high level.
Not ask me the part.
No, if you kill it, okay. Even though the security is enabled before, you change something, I mean, it doesn't bother about, you know, whether the security is enabled, because you are actually killing the process, okay, not the systematic way of killing, bringing down. But let's say you have a very
next time if you'll bring up the DMGR, then
so starting the server in WebSphere environment, okay, starting, anyone can start.
Okay,
see, starting is a good operation, right? I mean, when you compare, you know, the operation of bringing down something, right?
Because you will be showing that also.
That is not part of the agenda to actually, you know, disable the security from the security XML. No, I'll tell you from the GUI mode, because that recommendation is not even given by IBM to, I mean, you know, to edit the files and I mean, kill the process and do it. Let's see. Let's put it
from WS admin, I guess.
No, we'll do it from the console itself. I mean.
Okay.